Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Negativity Remedy, Unlocking More Joy, Less Stress, and Better Relationships Through Kindness by Nicole J. Phillips, narrated by Emily Ellet. Introduction. My bestie Andrea has commented over the past several years about how kind I am, how easily kindness and compassion seem to come to me. She's not complimenting me. She's perplexed. Andrea has known me long enough to have had a front row seat to the transformation kindness has caused in my life. She is the one person, aside from my husband, who knows just how big my inner meanie can be. She's been insulted and beaten down by my inner meanie, and yet we remain besties. Therefore, I get it. Andrea has every right to say, "What happened here?" I used to drink like a fish. When I wasn't an absolutely hysterical drunk, I had a tendency to get mouthy and, well, mean. One night I went to a bar without my husband because I was angry with him for traveling so much. He's a college basketball coach, so of course he travels a lot. I wasn't surprised by it. I was just sick of it. I proceeded to drink so much that when a man tried to lure me into his car, I didn't even realize I was in jeopardy of being abducted. Everything turned out just fine. A girlfriend jumped in before I got hurt. But yes, the memory of that night and what could have happened still haunts me sometimes. And it all started because I handed the car keys to my inner meanie. You'd think that would have been enough to curb my enthusiasm for rum and cokes, but it wasn't. About a year later, I was with my husband at a campus bar when I started in on all his little flaws. It began as a joke that only my inner meanie found funny, and it ended in a display of public embarrassment for all involved. The next morning, I was lying on the carpet of my bedroom floor when my husband walked into our room. He simply and clearly stated, "You owe me an apology." I knew I owed him a whole lot more than that. I owed my husband and my children and everyone I loved a whole lot more than that. It was clear that something needed to change. I never took another drink again. Stone cold sober, but high on life, I traded in thoughts about when my next drink was coming for a daily journey with kindness. I stumbled upon the idea of using kindness to retrain my brain, thanks to a girl in fashionable boots. But you'll have to wait until chapter one to hear about her. Now, don't let me fool you into thinking I just did an act of kindness every time I wanted to have a drink. It wasn't that easy. There were a lot of things my husband and I had to rework in our relationship for me to get healthy. I spent a lot of time in the bathtub learning what it means to relax while he read bedtime stories to our kids. Instead of staying up late laughing and watching TV together, I went to bed at 9 o'clock, or whenever the urge to drink hit hardest. Eventually, I stumbled upon a secret. My drinking wasn't really about outside influences, stress levels, or the way people were treating me. Neither was my overall level of joy. It was about me. It was all determined by the lens through which I chose to see life. When I got an unexpected bill in the mail, when my husband had to work late, or when my toddler was whinier than usual, my first thought was, "I cannot wait to have a drink." I knew that drink would allow me to finally relax. I would be free from the world, because the world was the problem, right? Wrong. The drinking seemed like it was about other people, but it wasn't. It was about me. I had to get to the point where I realized my drinking had nothing to do with external circumstances, but instead had everything to do with how I was processing those situations. It was about my inability to see the good around me because I was so set in my ways of looking at everything as a negative. Even if you're not an alcoholic, placing the blame on the world creates a pathway of negativity in our lives. Luckily, there is a remedy. It's kindness. Once we learn to understand and use kindness to our advantage, the game changes. We begin to recognize kindness isn't about other people, it's about us. We help someone else when we give them a few dollars or a word of encouragement, but the life we transform with kindness is our own. I began writing a weekly column called Kindness is Contagious for newspapers in North Dakota and Minnesota. The thing about writing a weekly column is that you have to write it weekly, like every week. I asked readers to send in their stories of kindness and how it made them feel to give or receive that kindness. But if my inbox was empty, I still had to meet my deadline. The journalist in me was set on high alert for any potential material. I began noticing opportunities to help people out, and I became ultra aware of when people were helping me. Very quickly, my inner meanie was silenced, and my brain was retrained to see the good in the world. Within 1 year of being intentional about kindness, I quit drinking, quit smoking, stopped gossiping, lost 30 pounds, and re-fell in love with my husband. Yep, I was high on life. Still am. Do you ever feel like something is missing? Like true joy is so close and yet just out of reach? I lived in that spot for so long, never realizing there was an alternative. Our happiness isn't based on how others treat us. It's based on how we treat others and how we treat ourselves. I had way more control over my own life than I had ever accepted. I had the power to say no to the negativity I gave to myself and others. Guess what? So do you. So, back to Andrea. She has been pestering me for a while to, in her words, write a how-to book for the rest of us, meaning a how-to guide on what it takes to stomp out the negativity that creeps into our everyday interactions. How do we create more joy, less stress, and better relationships? This book is my attempt to teach people how to attain the life they really want to live. Even if no one else reads it, I know Andrea will. Probably. Since I've now opened my closet and had all the skeletons hop up and do a little dance for you, let me be totally honest about one more thing. I do not consider myself to be a kindness expert. I travel quite a bit for speaking events and interviews, but when people introduce me as a kindness expert, I cringe. We all get it wrong from time to time. I haven't perfected kindness, but I have experienced the way it can dramatically alter a life, and I know I'm called to share that secret with others. I see the power of kindness. It's not a fluffy concept that tastes like rainbow-flavored bubblegum. Kindness has real teeth. I know it can change your life because it changed mine. When I began to be intentional and systematic about kindness, I saw a radical transformation in my life. But don't let the words intentional and systematic scare you. This is not a weight loss program or a monthly budget. This is not meant to be one more thing on your to-do list. This is meant to help you see what's happening around you. It's a shift in perspective so you can see the good in the world and join the party. That's when fatigue and emptiness fall away and life becomes fun. Maybe negativity isn't a problem for you. You've got your inner meanie under control, and anger, resentment, and judgment have no place in your life. Maybe you just feel like something is off, like life is just a bit too mundane or predictable or passionless. Perhaps something is missing, but you can't figure out what it is. Good news. Kindness is like the insulating foam that builders use. At least I think that's what that stuff is. I have never actually built anything. You spray a little bit of foam, and it expands and fills all the empty space. It even helps keep you warm. No matter how kind we are, everybody has something to work on, and kindness can help. Throughout this book, we're going to identify our own inner meanie. Once we've found him, or her, we're going to crush him by rejecting and replacing our thoughts, by learning from researchers about what's happening in our bodies when we do an act of kindness, and by drawing more positivity into our lives. We'll also deal with the tough stuff, like what to do when people are mean to us, how to react when a good act of kindness goes bad, and how to answer the age-old question, how can I show more kindness to my family and other people who annoy me? When you latch on to kindness, you have a great tool at your disposal. It calms the places that are judgy and bitter and fills the places in your soul that are empty. All of a sudden, the world is not out to get you. You will realize telemarketers are just people trying to earn a living, and the person who waved at you with his middle finger on the freeway is just a guy stuck in a rut of bitterness. The silver lining becomes brighter than the gray clouds, and getting out of bed in the morning means looking forward to what the day will bring. Listen to this book and try it. Be intentional about kindness, and look back on your life a year from now. There will be calm in your household, more open conversations with your colleagues, and an immense sense of purpose in your life. Are you longing for those changes? Then tell your inner meanie to hold on tight, because we're about to blow him right out of this popsicle stand. 1. Lessons from Dinoland. Fargo, North Dakota. It was one of my favorite places to live, but not because of the great accents or the fun phrases I picked up like, oof-da, oofer cute, or yeah, you betcha. I loved Fargo for the people. People in Fargo are kind. Well, most of them. A store even came up with the best t-shirts that said kind using the North Dakota abbreviation. The thing is, nobody's kind all the time. Especially me. Especially when I was 35. Especially when I had a bit too much wine the night before. And it was snowing. And my kids didn't have school. And I felt like I was going to explode if I didn't get my children out of the house so they could expel their excess energy and loudness. Are you feeling the not my best day ever vibes? Ever been there? I can only imagine the look on my face when I tromped through the food court of our local mall. I had just spent 45 minutes corralling and loading up three small bodies in negative 20 degree temperatures. Now I was inside and sweating, and my kids were whining because they were sweating. I had exhausted any reserves of patience I may have had before leaving the house. But then we arrived. My sweet oasis, Dinoland. Dinoland is the place in the mall where parents go when they need to sit and look at their phones while their kids crawl all over gigantic plastic triceratops and brontosaurus statues. My sweet little girl Jordan, who was 7 at the time, ran ahead of me with her 5-year-old brother Charlie. They could not wait to discard their hats and snow boots. Meanwhile, I shuffled behind with a diaper bag of snacks in one arm and my snow-suited toddler Ben in the other. I made it. Finally, we were all properly unencumbered and situated. Jordan and Charlie stood on top of the T-Rex, while Ben sat at my feet digging through the diaper bag for his sippy cup. There was a young woman sitting next to me with long, dark hair. I noticed her because she was wearing real clothes, super cute jeans and little fashionable boots, and she even had her hair combed. I, on the other hand, hadn't made it to the shower that day and was wearing sweatpants. Yes, they were maternity sweatpants. Yes, my youngest child was well past his first birthday. Don't judge. I'm about to do enough of that for the both of us. I found myself mentally justifying my slovenliness. It's easy to get up and get ready for the day when you're the babysitter. You don't have a child pulling all of the towels out of your cupboard or being mysteriously quiet in another room. You can take a shower without having to make a decision between shaving your legs or conditioning your hair. Time is of the essence when you're the mom. This girl doesn't know how hard it is. Poor thing. Someday she's going to realize what it's like to be a mom. No time for playing fashionista then. When I looked down, I realized Ben had pulled a Houdini with the snacks and was now helping himself to the Cheerios. On the bright side, he was sharing the ones that fell on the floor with the little boy sitting next to him. I immediately started to panic under my breath about diseases and dying and possible dog poop that could all be associated with eating off the mall floor. Dinoland fashionista next to me started giggling. Then she pulled out her non-contaminated snacks and handed them to the boy at her feet. He grabbed a handful and then shared with Ben. It was then I noticed the girl was smiling and doing simple sign language with the toddler. Please and thank you and more. Nothing major, but enough to put her in the finals for world's best babysitter. I was trying to figure out how to launch a conversation with her so I could get her phone number without sounding like a stalker or a pathetic loser. If I could get her to babysit my kids, I would have time for naps and other activities that might bring more happiness to my life. But I didn't have to find the right words, because she did. However, what she said stopped me cold. Fargo cold. My son will be a year and a half next week. How old is your son? Wait, what? Son? And you showered today? This wasn't the world's best babysitter. This was the mom. She was maybe 17 or 18, and we had kids the same age. As we sat side by side watching our kids, who had waddled a short distance away, she lightheartedly shared her story with me, even though it involved an ex-boyfriend and broken promises. My heart sank as I realized that even with far fewer resources and a much smaller support system, the Dinoland fashionista was doing a much better job of being a mom than I was, because I could tell she was enjoying it. This was an unexpected wake-up call. I don't know when I had stopped enjoying being a mom. Maybe it was after 7 straight years without a full night of sleep. Maybe it was after my 728th load of laundry. By the way, that's a conservative estimate, assuming I'd done 2 loads of laundry a week for 7 years. I don't know. All I can tell you is this. That day when I walked into the land of dinosaurs, I was drained. Life felt passionless and pointless and mundane, like something everyone else was enjoying and I was only enduring. How could that be when I had the home, husband, and children I had always dreamed of? I knew I was missing something, but I couldn't figure out what that something was. I'd tried to fill that hole with food and alcohol and cigarettes and girls' nights out and shopping, but nothing seemed to stick. I knew I wasn't as happy as the people I saw out in the world and on social media, but I couldn't figure out why. If you hate me right now, that's okay. I was a bored housewife who had no trouble finding things to complain about. It was affecting my health and the well-being of my family. Looking back, I sort of hate me too. Except if I hadn't been in that place, I wouldn't be writing this book right now because of what came next. Dinoland fashionista and I started packing up our stuff at about the same time. The little boys needed their afternoon naps. That was when I got the biggest compliment of my life from a 17-year-old mom. "I can tell your kids really love you," she said. Wow, I so needed to hear that. Embarrassed by the leaking coming from my eyes, I turned and busied myself with finding a tiny snow boot. That was when a strange voice in my head said, "Stop. Give her some money." I hadn't heard that voice before, and if it was going to tell me to give away money, I'm not sure I wanted to hear it again. But I stopped. I reached into my purse and grabbed the last cash in my wallet, 2 $20 bills. I turned back to Dinoland fashionista. "I need to tell you something," I said. At this point, her body bristled just a little bit. I think her natural fight-or-flight reaction kicked in, and she braced for me to give her unsolicited advice that would perhaps hurt her feelings. Nevertheless, I continued. "I know we're never going to see each other again, but I have to tell you something. My best friend died of cancer when we were 30. That friend taught me about the power of women to lift up other women. I just want to say I'm glad I met you today. I'm so grateful you would remind me that my kids love me. I forget that sometimes. You have inspired me to be a better mom." I blabbed on and on for a few more minutes until I realized I was verbally vomiting all over the floor of Dinoland. I stopped talking and handed her the 20s. She stared at me. Then we both began to cry. Then she threw her arms around me and gave me a big hug. "Thank you," was all she said. I'd given her enough money to fill her gas tank and maybe take her kid to McDonald's. What I received in return is hard to put into words. I left the mall and got into my car with a high unlike any other. My skin had goosebumps, and they weren't from the weather. My entire being felt awake, alive, powerful. And most importantly, purposeful. In that moment, I knew if other people could feel what I was feeling, they would all want to try it. Kindness would be contagious. I went home and wrote down everything I was thinking and feeling that day. Then I sent it to the publisher of our local newspaper and asked if I could write a weekly column about kindness. That's the day Kindness is Contagious was born. I keep waiting to run out of stories of kindness, or for the newspaper people to fire me, but so far neither has happened. In fact, I keep traveling around the country, and they keep asking me to keep writing. Yay, kindness. A young, unsuspecting woman sitting in a mall playland changed the trajectory of my life. Within a year, I was a new person physically. I quit drinking, smoking, and overeating. Emotionally, my house became a tantrum-free zone, at least those perpetrated by Mom. And spiritually, I saw my life as having a clear purpose. But the point here isn't about me and my transformation from kindness. It's about you and the transformation kindness can bring to your life. I promise you, this is not rocket science. I failed freshman algebra 2 semesters in a row in college. I couldn't come up with a fancy formula even if I wanted to. This isn't difficult, but it is life-changing. And all it takes is going about our lives with a little less attention placed on how we're feeling and a little more attention placed on how others might be feeling. What does this look like on a daily basis? Let's say we hit the drive-thru first thing in the morning for our cup of joe. We pay, we pull out, and we take our first sip. Instead of getting a mint mocha white chocolate latte with extra whip, we realize we got a double shot dirty chai with coconut milk, no whip. In this moment, we have a choice. Will we react in anger or frustration and let that emotion set the tone for the day? Or will we think to ourselves, those poor people working in that drive-thru have already been on their feet for 4 hours. I'm so glad I don't have that job. It must be exhausting. Maybe we really want the mint drink, so we go back through the line. There, we are presented with another choice. Do I let the employees know that I am not pleased with this delay in my day? Or do I speak kindly and remind myself that I make mistakes too? Since we want people to give us grace, we have to be willing to extend it. An event planner was setting up a huge 3-day conference. She emailed the caterer ahead of time to remind him to have the breakfast buffet hot and ready by 7 a.m. Guess what? The caterer didn't show. It was completely his fault. He knew it, but he had made a mistake on his calendar and thought the conference began the following day. He was beside himself. This was a big client, a repeat client. There was nothing he could do except apologize. I know about this because I was the speaker at the conference. The event planner called me in a panic and said, "We need to move you up in the schedule. You first, then food. Come quickly." After I spoke to the group, I spoke to the event planner. "What are you going to do? Are you going to fire the caterer? Give him a piece of your mind?" She said he probably already had a pretty good idea of what was going on in her mind, even without her saying anything. But she thought through the situation and realized she really liked that caterer. He had always been great to work with in the past, and she knew losing this account would hurt his business. She decided to give him another chance. The caterer was thrilled and relieved, but the really cool thing was seeing how peaceful the event planner was with her decision. She felt good about giving grace. It was an act of kindness to forgive and move on, and it released her from any feelings of bitterness. We can't save up our pennies and buy the feelings kindness gives us. We can't make a checklist and decide that once those things are all completed, we will have joy. When I can afford a bigger house or go on that dream vacation or lose 20 pounds, I will be happy. These are not the things that will transform our lives. If we truly want to grab on to joy and be free of negativity, we only need to do one thing. Wake up each day with the intention of loving others well. Once we do that, we find kindness is sort of like a figure eight. We begin the day thinking we are out to make life better for others, and end the day realizing the one who really benefited was us. We walk down this path and intend to help someone else along the way, but in return, we are the ones getting our souls fed. We are the ones whose joy has radically increased. That freezing cold day in Fargo, back in 2011, I thought I was just paying back the kindness of Dinoland fashionista. She had made me feel so much better with her compliment, and I'd wanted to do something in return. I had no idea when I handed over the cash that the one whose life would be transformed was mine. I followed that high and traced it back to kindness. Kindness was the missing link in my life. When we realize that, when we really take hold of that powerful knowledge and learn how to use it, we become the ones who can help others find their missing link. And the circle of kindness is complete. Questions to ponder while you're waiting for the barista to remake your drink order. 1. What is one time when I extended grace to someone who needed it? How did that leave me feeling? 2. What can I do to remind myself each day to pay a little more attention to how other people might be feeling? 2. Identifying your inner meanie. Are you ready to jump on the kindness train? This is exciting stuff. But first, we need to identify what's holding us back. Let me officially introduce you to your inner meanie. Now I know what you're thinking. Hey, lady, I don't even know you. What makes you think I have an inner meanie? I'm a very nice person. Think you're pretty kind? Okay, let's take a test. A car pulls out in front of you, forcing you to slam on the brakes. Does your instant reaction have anything to do with raising one of your fingers? Is the word that pops out of your mouth one you'd say in front of your grandma? How about following the person who is driving 20 in a 35 miles per hour zone? They are making you late. Do you edge up behind them, hoping by hopping on their tail they will realize they need to move faster? Or do you remind yourself of all the reasons why they might be driving so slowly? Maybe it's a new driver feeling anxious and tentative behind the wheel. Maybe it's an old driver who knows their reactions aren't as quick as they once were. Or perhaps the person's mind is so full of worries about what's happening at home, they aren't thinking about their speed. Do you find compassion behind the wheel? Or does road rage take a lap around your brain? Next question. You come home from work and notice the dishwasher needs to be unloaded, the clean laundry needs to be folded, and dinner needs to be on the table before the kids run off to their evening activities. Your spouse walks in the door and immediately plops down on the couch with the remote control. How do you respond?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.